was born in Derry City. I grew up in that war-torn town as I watched.
This is a broadcast for the Family Campaign for Justice for Liam Campbell.
How do you fight back to get your right back to walk freely down the street when your name and address single?
The time for truth for Liam Campbell is well past due.
Don't hand me over, don't hand me over.
Liam is a lifelong Republican who is currently facing extradition to Lithuania based on a warrant for international weapons traffic. And these dubious charges are a result of a witch hunt by British military intelligence, MI5.
I kept my silence, I got more angry day by day.
Liam was first arrested in January 2009, which has now been a 12-year-long battle against extradition.
I left home, moved down to Dublin, not knowing what I'd find. When I got me a job and a place to stay, I thought I could leave the war behind. Don't hand me over, don't hand me over for a crime I haven't done. I'm not guilty and you know it, but you said one day you'd send me down. Then they began to watch me and to follow me round town. We know your name and where you come from, telling me that they would send me down. At dawn one morning I was arrested and extradited the very same day. I was terrorized and beaten so badly that I signed my life away. Don't hand me over, don't hand me over for a crime I haven't done. I'm not guilty and you know it, but you said one day you'd send me down. The rags in Fleet Street had a field day. If you were Irish, you were scum. Long before my trial was opened, media had me all but hung. English justice for Irish people, the case of the Birmingham Six sums it up.
Previous attempts to extradite Liam from the six counties were thrown out as the conditions that Liam would be held in were deemed to be a serious violation of his human rights. Lithuania was also exposed as having operated CIA black sites for torture and interrogation.
Don't hand me over, don't hand me over.
Despite all of this, Free State Judge Aileen Donnelly had ruled that Liam's extradition and rendition to Lithuania should go ahead. Liam has never even set foot in Lithuania.
My name's Michael Campbell. I'm Liam Campbell's brother. I'm here just to inform people about how his rights will be violated if he is sent to Lithuania. He is currently fighting now for nearly 12 years not to be extradited, and what he will endure if he is sent out, and type of thing. First of all, he will be took out and he will be in a police station or whatever for 7 days. He'll be held there and questioned and whatever, put to him or whatever. Translator might be able to translate for him or not, because the translator that I had when I was there worked for the prosecutor and also was to give me my legal advice from a state-appointed solicitor. So you have no independent advice for once from your arrested. I was arrested on the 22nd of January. It was minus 25. I was set up. It was an MI5 entrapment sting. I was arrested. I was taken to the police station. And I wasn't even taken inside the police station. I was stripped naked outside the police station in the snow. Then they took me into the police station and give me back some of my clothes and set about questioning me. I was held in a cell on my own for 7 days at that stage, and had different interviews with a prosecutor, with a Lithuanian appointed solicitor who couldn't speak English, and the same translator for the two of us, for the prosecutor asking me the questions and my own confidential advice with the solicitor. So I had no private advice. After that, I had no phone calls. There was nothing like that. I couldn't let anybody know where I was. After the 7 days is up, through different interviews where I just used my right to silence, you are taken to a remand prison and you're held in quarantine for up to a week. You're in a cell, you could be with 3 people, 4 people, 12 people, whatever it is. And it's only a hole in the ground for your toilet. So it is. And you're only given 2 rolls of toilet paper, basically, for a month. That's what every prisoner is allocated. While I was in the prison, Lithuanian State Department officials or whatever, with fluent English, would come to me and interview me. My wife was arrested with me. She was also with me in Lithuania. She was arrested at a hotel. And they held her for 4 months. And during all of them 4 months, they kept coming to me and questioning me and putting pressure on me, looking for answers to questions that I couldn't answer. And just basically saying they were holding her till I would answer whatever they wanted me to answer, which I couldn't. So after the 4 months, Amnesty International stepped in and she was released. And all, no charges, no nothing, returned home, and that was it. She went through an awful tough time. She had no visits, no phone calls either for them 4 months. She wasn't aware of anything, even though we were literally down the hall from each other, we weren't allowed to see each other. During this time then, you're held for 18 months. During these 18 months, I did not get any phone calls or a visit, even though you constantly apply to the courts and the prosecutor refuses every time. That went on, so I never got a phone call for up until 19 months later. I got a phone call, got my first phone call, and I was only granted one phone call for 5 minutes. That was it. And I had to go to court again, and eventually I got one phone call a week. That's what I was getting. I didn't get no visits for 3 years. I never spoke to anybody. After my wife was released, as I said, the State Department never came to interview me again. We kept applying to courts and everything for visits. We never got them. The conditions in the jail were you were either with 4, 6, you could be with 12 people in the cell. There was an awful lot of self-harm in the cells because prisoners had nowhere to go. Basically, you were in the cell, that was it. There's no such thing as TV or anything like that. All you done was sat in the cell. There's no radio, no nothing. And if they seen that you started to talk to anybody or got friendly, they were moved or you were moved. On a couple of occasions, boys had cut their wrists and you'd bang on the doors for security to come and help. And they would just basically gesture back that it was your problem. So that type of thing we got out to an exercise yard, which was just the same size as your cell, basically, with an open roof with mesh across it. Showers you only got once a week, and basically nearly always cold water, even though it was freezing cold, minus 25 outside. After 18 months, they decided that they would charge me. So I did not get a book of evidence. So the process out there is that you're taken from your cell, you're tucked down to a visiting room, and you're shown the book of evidence with the prosecutor or a translator to tell you what's in it. And the translator that I was given for to tell me what was in the book of evidence was actually a play school teacher. And she actually couldn't carry on a conversation in English. So the legal team argued this point, and eventually a proper qualified translator was given to me, but I still never got to look back over the evidence that they said, or that I had already seen with her. You don't get a book of evidence that you can study. You get to see it for whatever, 2 hours or whatever it is. There could be 15, 16, 20 folders in your case, and that's all you get to see, one folder a day, and to study it. You can make notes, but you don't get to study it yourself. The witnesses in the case give evidence from behind screens, and during the court you could hear them being prompted by what for to say, what they were being told what to say. We challenged this in the court, but the judge just let it go. Also during the court, they sent out a criminal record for a Michael Campbell from County Louth, which wasn't mine. I haven't got a criminal record. And they accepted this entire criminal record of another Michael Campbell, really in-depth information, and they just let it go that this, the records that this man had, said it was mine. I would write home anything that I had seen in the book of evidence or anything like that. And when I would write home, a letter would take 3 months to go home. And by the time I got a reply back, it would be another 3 months. So basically, you're renting from 6 months to 5 to 6 months behind on any letter or anything you requested for information or for to defend yourself in the case. So I couldn't defend myself in the case. And I was found guilty and I was sentenced to 12 years. The prosecutor wanted 15. He appealed the case, which I later then won, because once you're sentenced, the restrictions basically relax on you a bit. So I was allowed one phone call a week, and post was able to come basically every week and a half. So I was able to write and communicate a lot better. And in the follow-up case, we were able to prove things were wrong, weren't mine, weren't other people's things, and everything, and witness statements, we were able to contradict them and everything and all this, and I won my case and I walked free from the court with my legal team. So I did. Also during the court, family members had come out for to see the court and were banned from it. I had not seen anybody or family member for 3 years, like, and they were banned from the court. And this is going to be the procedure, that if Liam was sent out there, he will be facing these type of conditions and how his rights will be violated. When I walked out of the court, the prosecutor retried, wanted to appeal the case for a retrial again. And at this stage then I had travelled home to County Loud at home here. And they basically sacked my defence that I had, that won the case, and they reappointed another legal team, another solicitor, who never spoke to me, never made any contact with me whatsoever. And I was found guilty in it, and they found me guilty to exactly the time that I had been in Lithuania, which was 5 years, 9 months, and whatever days. That's what they did with that. When my decision was made that I was free to go, the judge in the case really slandered the prosecutor and for the case that it was total entrapment and MI5 involvement and the illegal activity of what they'd done in different jurisdictions that they had no permission to be in. Yet they had written permissions to be in Lithuania, but no written permissions to be anywhere else, but they just broadly accepted everything. And the judge really condemned them on their entrapment and how it was done. When I got home and they knew the case was going on in my absence, I wasn't aware of it because they had sacked my defence. That's all I was aware of. My defence had notified me that they were sacked from the case, and that was it. What happened next was then I was at home and I was listening to the local radio station, just as you would be. And next thing I heard them talking about me and how I was sentenced and found guilty to crimes in Lithuania, allegedly. And I was sentenced to 5 years, 9 months, and whatever days. Basically just time served. And this is what they done. That was how I found out about my sentence on the local radio. So when I had found out about my verdict, another thing now that we should just discuss is that Liam had fought 3 extradition cases in the north. Lithuania already had the case started in Dublin, and they decided then to drop it when he was arrested in the north. And he won all his cases in the north and actually fought it the whole way to London. He won that and he returned home. And now Lithuania has activated another warrant in the south for extradition, which is an abuse of process. Trying to extradite him to a country that he was never in. Never sat foot in it. So,